You're listening to the Unsung Podcast, where we talk about albums that we think are unsung classics, and then you guys tell us if you're right or wrong. This is the Unsung Podcast. You're listening to the Unsung Podcast. I'm your host Mark Fraser, and this week I am joined by the Mega Powers, that is Hulk Hogan and Macho Man Randy Savage.
Was that the name of their tag team?
That was the name of their tag team, yeah. The Mega Powers.
I feel like I should have known that.
Pretty good. To my direct in front of me is... oh my god, you're just looking straight into my soul right now.
I've closed my eyes.
Through your feet.
To give you a rest.
Oh, I was going to say something good earlier about him, but I've forgotten it.
Damn.
I don't know.
There was something good to say about me?
Yeah.
And you've forgotten it.
Straight ahead of me is
a man
Chris
who's less racist than the Hulk Hogan.
I mean, I'd hope so. And less Randy than Macho Man Randy Savage.
More Randy, less macho is bro.
Have you got a Miss Elizabeth yet?
I feel like we've got Dean Meltzer in there.
I don't know who that is.
Of course you don't, David.
Are you going to introduce me? Can I just say, like, before you introduce me, I want to show you my new item of clothing that I'm very excited about.
Okay.
This is why I've got the anorak on. So you might have seen that last night in Glasgow, there were a couple of gigs on. Behemoth. Supported by Wolves in the Throne Room and At the Gates.
Sold out, I believe. Yeah.
Sold out. Mm-hmm. So obviously I went to the best gig in Glasgow and got merch.
Wow, none more black.
A photograph of this.
I went to see fucking Tears for Fears at the Hydro, and I have to say it was fucking all I could have wanted. It was magnificent.
How was Songs from the Big Chair?
They played three tracks from that. They opened with Everybody Wants to Rule the World. I mean, that's a pretty fucking strong opener, isn't it?
It is.
Yep.
I remember you trying to coerce me into thinking they were all right.
They fucking are.
I'm actually coming round to them.
Yeah. Interestingly enough as well, they were supported by Alison Moye.
Really?
Of Yazoo fame and also Alison Moye solo fame.
And honestly, like, I mean, I'm a little bit fatigued. I'm a little bit ill. I've been working pretty hard. I just crossed wires in my head there and I thought you were still talking about Behemoth.
Oh.
And that was a genuine facial reaction. That was like, Alison Moye supported Behemoth.
I mean, that is the gig that I would have wanted to see. There would have been a crowd of me there.
And if Behemoth had started with Everybody Wants to Rule the World, that would be pretty good as well.
Yeah.
I mean, there is going to be a lot of that today, I'm afraid. I'm in richest
capacity.
You're jet lagged
after your big jet setting travel from, where were you?
Madrid. Yeah,
I had a full 2.5 hours in that
Oh
plane.
My god, that must be okay. I'm tired as well.
That's right.
How many time zones is that away from?
Sick.
Is it like 19 hours or something? One day.
See this thing with aeroplanes, like the fact that when people could smoke in aeroplanes, they literally used to have a vastly better air quality than now. Because since they passed the rules about not being able to smoke in public places, the airlines realized they could save loads and loads of money over the course of, you know, obviously a full year in terms of the extra drag factor that comes from having to ventilate your cabins. So now they don't have to ventilate the cabins because there's not a smell of smoke in them. They save a bunch of cash, but what it means is the cabins are just a petri dish of fucking garbage, and I think I inhaled all of it. And I believe you too.
Yeah, I fly quite a lot, so I'm no stranger to that nonsense. I was going to say, do you know that by law, even though it's illegal to smoke in an airplane, by law they need to have an ashtray in the toilet.
Why?
In case somebody does smoke in an airplane. It's a really strange
really strange thing, but by law, all airplanes have to have ashtrays in the toilet.
I have noticed that, yeah. They do still have...
Yeah, it's really strange.
I don't feel qualified enough to dispute that, but it seems...
It's fucking... backwards.
You do
fuck,
notice that all airplane toilets still do have ashtrays, and you're like... I very rarely go to the bathroom in an airplane.
Same. Ever.
I've got a vast bladder.
See, David's diet is now calculated down to the last like micronutrient, so there's no wastage.
Yeah, exactly.
You're a super efficient organic farm.
Let's meet.
Speaking of super efficient or organic
meat, or let's meet substitute. Yeah, here I thought I wasn't going to be informed, but turns out I'm fine.
Alright, so what are we doing this week, lads?
What are we doing this week?
Mark's face is tripping him because for some reason he's unhappy that we decided to do a Trail of Dead head to head.
It's total bullshit. It's finger on the scale bullshit.
And you will know us by the Trail of Head to Head.
Every time we do a mixtape, that is finger on the scale.
Yeah, so we were talking about two And You Will Know Us by the Trail of Dead albums.
A strange thing happened actually because David and I found our research dragging us in different directions. So last week, I was completely prepared to defend the third Trail of Dead album, Sources, Tags and Codes. Mm-hmm. And David was in the position of arguing in favour of Madonna. And then during the course of the week, I'll be honest, I was like, I actually don't think I believe in that. And then I kind of got the impression from David's message that he was sort of having second thoughts. So I kind of suggested, Do you want to swap?
Do you want to swap? And 3 hours just before we record.
Bit my hand off and I was like, yes. So David and I have actually swapped. And that's going to inform the argument quite well, I think, because clearly we both really like the other's suggestion.
Yeah.
But we have now swapped sides and I am arguing in favour of Madonna and David is arguing in favour of Sources, Tags and Codes.
It's Source, Tags and Codes. There's no S in Sources. There's no plural. I don't know if have you not done a higher computing class? It's Source, Tags and Codes is it's all HTML web code in chat. Hmm. And a source tag is like a little bit in the bottom for metadata. But anyway, the album's called Source, Tags and Codes.
So Trail of Dead, as we'll call them, because there's no way we're saying And You Will Know Us by the Trail of Dead, because this will end up as another two-parter, is largely Jason Rees and Conrad Keeley. There have been many, many, many other musicians involved in it, including a guy called Kevin Allen, who joined in guitar in 95 and was until, I think, about 2010, and a guy called Neil Bush, who was on bass from 95 till about 2005, as well as since then a whole host of people, including a guy called Autry Fulbright, who is also in a band called Midnight Masses with Jason Rees. But there's a cast of characters in Trail of Dead, but fundamentally it's Jason and Conrad, and Jason and Conrad take turns drumming and singing and playing guitar from song to song and single to single. Maybe Conrad's slightly more prominent as the front man.
Very similar to Tears for Fears, in fact. That sort of dual front man. Sort of sharing the limelight.
It's probably where they
got both with quite similar voices, but one's slightly higher than the other. Both, you know, still really nailing it live.
I imagine that's exactly who they were trying to emulate, yeah. And as you say, still nailing it live. Just last week, I went to the 20th anniversary of Madonna. They're touring it live, and it was excellent. I mean, I saw them do this album when it came out in 1999. And
my God.
Yeah, there was a level of energy there. And just abandon. Trail of Dead are very well known for very destructive live performances in their youth. Mm-hmm. In their heyday, a lot of things got destroyed, including, I believe, Mogwai's drum kit. Mm-hmm. They toured over here with Mogwai in their first kind of proper trip to Europe. And Mogwai gave them gear and they absolutely mangled that gear during the destruction of a
set.
Yeah.
But they're really good friends with Mogwai, I think. Mm. They were getting a heavy shout out at the gig the other night. But yeah, Trail of Dead were a really destructive live band. Everything got thrown everywhere. The shows were quite shambolic, but it really fitted with the music. They're not so now, but they're 20 years older now. You can kind of forgive them that.
Well, that's fine.
In fact, pretty much everybody I saw that night that I knew was in a pretty good mood. They're a band that brought a lot of different people together. I mean, mm-hmm. Steven and his kind of hardcore, mathcore crowd, Neil from Hey Enemy, and Neil's into everything from like Tom Waits and Nick Cave through to Steely Dan. People that were into some real noisecore stuff, Melvins-y sort of stuff. There were guys there that were in that scene. Some of the old kind of grunge crew were there. The guys from United Fruit were there. Like Trail of Dead have this really interesting ability to gel a lot of different scenes by covering a lot of different influences within their music.
Funnily enough, the time that I saw them first, it was actually a kind of a defining moment of my life because it was so fucking hilarious. It was at South by Southwest, where they actually made their name back in the 90s. They're from Austin, Texas. And I think it was 2011, 2012. But anyway, we were over there doing some filming and Trail of Dead was like the meeting point for everybody. Like they were playing at like 2 a.m. and everybody was over there. Like all the Scottish guys all went off and did their own thing and did different gigs and we were filming and we obviously got exceptionally drunk. I was there with my partner in crime, Ali McRae, who disappeared at one point. And then when we got back, there was like all the guys from all the Scottish bands and were there. And then Ali turned up halfway through this Trail of Dead set, which was fucking amazing, by the way. It was in this little wooden pub next to a river. Grabbed me, took me outside, then lifted up his sleeve to show me a freshly inked tattoo of my name, David Weaver, on his arm. The only tattoo that he had, his first tattoo, saying David Weaver. And I looked at him. His drunken eyes, and I said, "Why?" And he said, "Just to see your face." So I hope it was worth it. That night, we then ended up, Ben Cowie, our cameraman, lost his phone that ended up in the hands of a homeless man who phoned his entire family and ran up a huge bill. Ben, then we saw a gig on the top of a old American, like yellow school bus at 4 a.m. We got locked out. It was a good night, and Trail of Dead were the soundtrack to it. And it's fucking amazing. And the fact was, like, everybody from all the different bands, there was like fucking Twin Atlantic were there, Errors were there, Withered Hand were there. So it was like folk, indie, electronica. And all of these guys were like, yes, we're going to see Trail of Dead at the end. Just everybody fucking loved Trail of Dead. So yeah. It was really interesting.
Did the tramp that phoned Ben's family, what did he talk about? Did they have a chat?
No, I think he was trying to be helpful and try to find out whose phone it was. He was like, "Oh, hey guys, I got a phone."
It's a good accent, by the way.
Thanks.
I feel like I'm there
in Austin in a hobo's nest.
But do you guys know what the capital of Texas is?
It is Austin.
Good answer. Everybody thinks it's Dallas.
Yeah, because they're bigger. Dallas and Houston are both much bigger, but Austin is the state capital.
Yep, there you go.
Anyway, welcome to Chris Mark and Weaver's geography quiz time.
Yeah, Trail of Dead. They also, by the way, did some really interesting support slots. Now, I know there's a weird Trail of Dead support slot that I can't remember because I was at the show the other night with Neil and a guy called Laurie McGowan, and they had seen them with somebody that I was like, what? No way, they supported so-and-so. And I got home and I was trying to remember who he'd said. I was like, is it Guns N' Roses? No, it wasn't them. But it's somebody absurd that they got a support slot with that I had no idea they'd supported. Trust me, David, I know you're reaching for your phone, but I spent a wee while this afternoon trying to work out
who
it was.
No, but did they not? I mean, this, and I know it seems early to go into the Nexus, but did they not support Foo Fighters?
They did.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they toured with Mogwai in 99. The year after, they supported Foo Fighters with that There's Nothing Left to Lose tour.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
And in 2002, they supported Queens of the Stone Age. They also supported another band that I'm not going to mention because it is the start of my Nexus. And I hope David doesn't say it just now because he looks like he's about to try and pull the rug out from under me.
No, did we just go to the Nexus then since we brought it up twice?
I mean, we've never done the Nexus before the actual bulk of the show, but we can do that.
Oh, it's fine. Let's just do the fucking Nexus because, you know, gets out of the way.
Who needs rules, man?
You know, Mark's a stickler for format.
Who needs rules, man? Who needs rules?
The rules are out the window. Right, cool. Let's do the Nexus thing, guys. Let's play some of Fritz's masterpiece.
It's the Unsung Podcast. Dave Grohl Nexus. Need to find a way to connect the show to that guy. For playing in Nirvana. To have It's the Unsung Podcast, Dave Grohl Nexus. Don't take too long,
By the way, I think we should be considering a single release for that Nexus music. At this point,
Fritz should be considering a single release.
At this point, we could probably get a couple of hundred sales on that if you did it for a good cause, and that's enough to scratch your charts now. So, Fritz, I'm just saying, if you let us.
Yeah.
So who wants to go first in this Nexus?
Well, you can go first, Chris, because you have a band you want to talk about. So, a weird support band.
I think you're overstating that, but I will go first. And you will know us by the Trail of Dead. In 2002, supported a little-known rock band called Sex Pistols.
Oh, really?
Well then, that is punk.
In London, also on that bill, hell of a show, guys. Also on that bill were the Dropkick Murphys, Amen, and the Libertines.
That's a pretty, I mean, I can see that's some guy, right, with his fucking jeans turned up and his fucking flat cap and a booking office in Brixton thinking, let's put on like the ultimate punk show.
Let's put on the fucking the live energy super bands. Yeah, like, we'll need to get so many drum kits in here. Fucking yeah.
So we'll get the crazy American bands and then we'll get the crazy English bands.
The Libertines.
How do you think those crowds gelled?
Who's the
Venn diagram of that?
But like, I can see how each band could slightly be attached to one another. Because like,
you can join the dots easily.
You can join the dots between Libertines and Trail of Dead. Yeah. And then obviously Trail of Dead to like Amen. But you cannot ever join the dots from...
It's not that obvious, is
it? No, it's not obvious. But I mean, they're both like... Trail of Dead definitely have indie sensibilities. Libertines occasionally have punk sensibilities.
I tell you what you could do. You could join Trail of Dead to Stereophonics.
Is this what you're doing?
This isn't what I'm doing, but I did consider going this way because as the gentleman at the Trail of Dead show, Neil McCulloch, he first heard Trail of Dead on a cover mount CD on a box of Cinnamon Grahams.
Oh, holy fuck. I had that CD. There was a green one and a blue one.
Exactly. There were two of them. And Trail of Dead were on that. And it was Blight Takes All, I think.
That's what happens when you sign to a major label.
Swed were on there as well, I think.
Actually, Mark, eggs on your face, mate, because they were not on a major label at that point.
Yeah, but that song is on Soulstag, is it not?
Nope. That song is on Madonna.
You sure?
Mm-hmm. Huh? Given that that's the album I've got to analyse for this show. Yep.
I hope you know that.
But they were on that next to A Thousand Trees by Stereophonics.
Yeah, I truly remember. No, it wasn't a green and a blue one. That came later. I think that was the follow-up. There were green and pink, actually. Oh, yeah. I wonder if I still have those CDs somewhere in the loft.
I'm also going to go so far as to say I don't think they were called Cinnamon Grahams then. I think they were called...
There was Golden Grahams and then Cinnamon Grahams. And then now they're called Curiously Cinnamon.
Ah, that's right.
Yeah, so Cinnamon Grahams was the original name.
Right. A delicious cereal, by the way.
Delicious cereal, but I can't eat them.
Made by Nestle.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I mean, really, really delicious. But you're giving money to Nestle.
Exactly. It's always been... It's literally my favourite cereal and I can't buy them. Yeah. And now I can't eat them. Twice.
That's really delicious dry as well. But you
do get really large ones in America that are like
cinnamon
fucking
toast, crunch,
biscuit.
Cinnamon toast.
Something. No, I think they're just called cinnamon golden grahams, but they're like biscuit size.
Given
they're
that
fucking amazing.
We do not like them, we're doing a really good job endorsing them.
Yeah. Anyway.
Could do a whole bit in dying babies in Africa because of Nestle, but we'll avoid that.
Could also just do a whole bit on cereal.
Yeah,
I fucking love cereal.
I think we should do that. Could we? A bonus episode on cereal.
Maybe we could just start a new episode called Cereal, pretend to be like cereal. Cereal killer podcast, but we just talk about cereals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
sure.
Anyway, this has been a long Nexus. Don't you dare cut any of this out, Chris. This is all gold in Grahams.
I seen that coming.
Trail of Dead.
I hate you.
Support. I'm gonna push through here. Trail of Dead supported Sex Pistols. Sex Pistols are fronted by a guy called John Lydon.
Really fucking loves butter.
Johnny Rotten and his penchant for butter, especially when butter pays him a fortune to advertise it. Mm-hmm. But John Lydon, amongst many redeeming factors, is a big fan of both Brexit and Nigel Farage. And also quite a fan of Donald Trump. As regards Brexit and Farage, in Brexit he said, the working class have spoken and I'm one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And he described Nigel Farage as fantastic. He also thinks that Donald Trump is a complicated fellow who has been smeared by the left-wing media.
Smeared by butter.
So he publicly came out on morning television to defend Nigel Farage. Nigel Farage, who, by the way, his two children have German passports now that the Brexit debacle is almost upon us, it's good to know that his offspring will have free movement. So Nigel Farage has a friend in the Ecuadorian embassy called Julian Assange.
That guy?
Nigel Farage has been to visit Julian Assange on at least one, I think multiple occasions, and he's been interviewed as he's been leaving, you know, just in there. He needed some shopping, whatever. Julian Assange is affiliated with an organisation known as WikiLeaks. WikiLeaks has been found to have been in communication with a fella called Roger Stone, who was indicted a few weeks ago now. Roger Stone, who has a giant tattoo of Richard Nixon between his shoulder blades and was an advisor on all manner of nefarious political campaigns, none more so than Donald Trump's.
There's a really good documentary on Netflix about him, if you've ever seen it.
Give me Roger Stone.
Yeah.
Roger Stone, who, by the way, also works for InfoWars, could have gone that direction. Roger Stone was in regular communication with a fella calling himself Guccifer 2.0. Guccifer 2.0 is mooted to be a resident of Moldova, but he's not a he. He seems as most likely an entity that is an umbrella for a number of people that were, as far as the CIA are concerned, contracted by the FSB, which is the modern version of the KGB in Russia, at the behest of the Russian government under the direct instruction of a Mr. Vladimir Putin, who, by the way, when you see his young photos, looks a little bit like Tom York.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I can't fucking believe that you've got Putin in your trail of dead nexus.
And,
as do I.
Isn't it?
Via completely different routes. For fuck's sake.
And Vladimir Putin was instructed by a certain former American president, Mr. Barack Hussein Obama, to knock it off as regards his blatant interference in the American electoral process. And Barack Obama, as we've established, was interviewed by Dave Grohl for the Stinky Highways documentary series.
Yep.
So yeah, Stinky Highways, Dave Grohl.
Great.
Nexus complete.
Good
next
work. Do you want, well, shall I go?
See, yes, please.
I've
do
somehow got fucking put in as well. I've done, it's a lot shorter, but Trail of Dead, what record was it? I think it was their 8th record, Lost Songs. Featured a track called Up to Infinity, which was dedicated to Pussy Riot, the Russian,
that's true,
punk act. And Pussy Riot, of course, famous, now a collective, they were a band, but now they're a sort of political collective, jailed in Vladimir Putin's Russia.
He's a very naughty boy.
He's seems to be quite on the ball, though, in terms of dictating.
Dictator,
just dictating. Yeah, exactly.
I think the word that's most appropriate is dictator. And
I'll tell you, a big Russian lad who wasn't as on the ball, and that's Boris Yeltsin, the previous Prime Minister of Russia.
He was on the bottle.
He was supremely on the bottle, and I don't know if you remember reading the story about Boris Yeltsin being found outside the White House in his underpants trying to hail a cab. I think he was trying to go to a bar or something. He was, Yeltsin was just permanently pissed the entire time, including trying to hail a cab in his underpants to go and get pizza outside the White House.
David, if you were ever the head of Russia, you would definitely do that.
I mean, I am not judging this lad, to be honest. He's some man.
They would probably have delivered as well.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. That's how drunk he was. He didn't realise he could get pizza delivered. Do you know, I did actually see the other day an advert for Pizza Hut from, must have been late 80s, early, no, it must have been early 90s Russia, with Gorbachev in it. He's in a Pizza Hut advert.
Wow.
And there's just lots of people sitting around a Pizza Hut restaurant with the Kremlin in the background. And then Gorbachev sits down and has a pizza, and there's like two people discussing, you know, whether he was a good guy or a bad guy. And then, like, the program just says, well, he brought us Pizza Hut. And then they all go, oh, that's fine then. It's fucking amazing. So that's a real thing that exists. Anyway, Yeltsin, at the time, he hailed for that cab to go get pizza. He was staying with a certain Mr. Bill Clinton, famous saxophonist and sex offender. Well, I don't know if I'd go that far, but possibly.
Yeah, I mean, he probably was a sex offender.
He offended using sex.
Well, no, I think he probably was a sex offender as well. He's an alleged rapist.
So yeah.
Just weren't ever able to prove it.
He's a white man from the 90s, so, you know. Mm. Anyway, of course, Bill Clinton is famously married to the infinitely more powerful Hillary Clinton.
The nefarious devourer of children's souls.
Yeah,
literally the single most evil entity. She can bewitch any man and make him do anything.
She really famously likes pizza. She's got her own pizza shop by here.
That's right. Aye, big pizza tie in here,
so
David.
So here's somebody talking about Hillary Clinton and, well, first of all, Donald Trump. Look at it from a very simple equation. You have a nationalist populist who's saying everything is broken and it needs to be fixed. Many, many people feel that way, and that idea can only resonate if many, many people feel that something needs to be broken before it can be fixed. Then on the other hand, you have basically an open globalist saying everything is fine, nothing to see here, let's just march forward and we're going to make it better. That anti-Hillary, pro-Trump chat came from a Mr. Billy Corgan on
Legend.
InfoWars in July 2016. So a classic lad there, Mr. Billy Corgan.
Double mention InfoWars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, Billy Corgan, I mean, you can get to Dave Grohl pretty easily. He attended Dave Grohl's 50th birthday in 2014, even having previously said that my criticism of the Foo Fighters is if I'm being a music critic, they just haven't evolved. They've just been making the same thing over and over. But he still managed to go to Dave Grohl's 50th birthday.
Perhaps an even more interesting final connection, although we can't really prove it, is that Billy Corgan claims, I think it was in Joe Rogan, that he was having sex with a famous actress / celebrity who shapeshifted into a lizard person in front of his eyes as they were having sex, thereby convincing him that the Illuminati are real, and that the chat is that was Courtney Love that he was talking about. And Courtney Love, Kurt Cobain, Dave Grohl.
That sounds entirely plausible.
But did he stop having sex with the other person as well? What, or did he just
maybe that's just what continue? Helped him finish.
Mm-hmm. Could be.
He's like, whoa. Yes.
Mark, your Nexus?
It's not as interesting as you guys. I don't have Vladimir Putin. I don't have Barack Obama. I don't have lizard people.
You don't have Vladimir Putin on a Trail of Dead Nexus? What did you come up with?
Other than the literal Trail of Dead, he's no doubt left across many continents over the course
will,
of his.
And you will know him by the
Trail of Dead. The first Trail of Dead album was produced by Chris Frenchy-Smith, who also worked with Slayer, The Meat Puppets, and a little known Australian band called the Datsuns.
Well, you had a quicker link from Meat Puppets who played live on Nirvana Unplugged.
I know. Could have went there, but I didn't. Because I've got a kind of interesting fact for the Datsuns. He produced the Datsuns' fifth album, Death Rattle Boogie, which was in 2012. And
fucking hell, yeah. They're still going in 2012.
Yeah. And in 2004, Lars Ulrich loved the Datsuns so much that he asked them to open for them on their Australian tour, where they were roundly fucking booed by Metallica's fan base, as you would do, of course.
My lord.
Yeah, that second album, as I said, was released in 2004. Their second album was released just before that, and it was produced by John Paul Jones. And as we know, Dave Grohl is a really big fan of Led Zeppelin. Also, he was in a band with John Paul Jones.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a better connection than he was a fan of Led Zeppelin.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I know folk that are a fan of Led Zeppelin. It doesn't mean they're connected to John Paul Jones.
We are all connected.
And again, the Nexus expands. Okay, Fritz, play us out. Here we go! One thing about this band, I think, that can't be overstated is just how broad they're not in terms of like massive numbers, but how varied their audience is because of all those various touchstones. I was trying to think of
which is why I think we'd probably agree that any of their records are unsung, because I don't think they're unsung in sort of respected indie or alternative music circles, mm-hmm. but in terms of general mainstream sales, they never reached, you know, the sort of major label success that I think the executives might have wanted.
Then they might have wanted, maybe. We've got so many different flavours of unsung here. One of the points I'm going to make is actually I don't understand how Trail of Dead got the success they got. Not because I don't think they're a great band, I think they are, but I don't see how their music's palatable to such a wide audience. I mean, I would love it if we lived in a world where that kind of music was rewarded on merit, but they go against the tide for me. I mean, I think their stuff's great, but I was surprised that they took off. I was surprised to see them in the front cover of NME, but at least once, but I think multiple times. I was surprised to see them get the plaudits that they got. I don't really get that about Trail of Dead. I think they're wonderful, but somehow they got a traction that so many other bands of their ilk just didn't get.
I think they had the melodic sensibility that was able to attract indie fans that weren't necessarily into heavier stuff normally.
But ironically, that I would argue that that melodic sensibility only really came to the fore probably after Source Tags and Codes.
No, I disagree. I think you listen to Madonna and there's big melodies on there that aren't...
They don't pop out,
and I think that's why music fans like them. But like the actual melodies that you find just below the surface are very palatable for a wide range of music fans.
Well, let me kind of like quote or paraphrase Neil, who I was speaking to you about this at the Trail of Dead show, when he got his Cinnamon Graham's cover mount CD, mm-hmm. And he was saying that the only band he really took away from that was Trail of Dead, and the reason he took them away was because it was ramshackle, it was noisy, the vocals were buried, it sounded punky and it was cacophonous, and you know, you had the Stereophonics on there, you had all these other indie and Brit rock bands on there, then you had this just non sequitur weird American noise rock band, mm-hmm. who, yeah, okay, they were very indie at points, but he was like, even just in that context, they really stood out. Now, him being somebody with quite alternative tastes, that's why he took away something away from that. But I would say, looking at that from the other perspective, how did this band catch on amongst Stereophonics fans? You know, you can't imagine something like Aged Dolls or even something like Mistakes and Regrets, the speed, the noise, the rambunctious kind of approach.
I know, but I think they had a huge buzz coming from their live act. They were coming from Texas, and I think they were tied in with At the Drive-In a little bit. And At the Drive-In had that same sort of pan-genre success that Trail of Dead, even more so.
That's a good point, because At the Drive-In are another band that I don't always understand where the traction came from, because it is so rackety. You know, it is not tied into strict 4/4. It's got
The Beastie Boys signed At the Drive-In with their record label. Obviously, their record label was an imprint on a major label, Grand Royale. So I mean, it makes sense that they would be attracted as a vanity label to putting out a band like that. Mm-hmm. But I totally see what you're saying. They're not in that category. But this just comes down to the same conversation we had when we talked about the Bronx as well. Those Tags and Codes came out the same year or the year after, year before, first Bronx record. And it was just a lot of money kicking around at the scene. In the scene at the time, and they just wanted bands that could do new and different things.
Yeah, but think about it, Madonna came out in 99.
Yeah.
That's 4 years prior.
The major label was in 2002, so they obviously get signed at some point in between.
But they were already appearing on cereal boxes.
Yeah, but do you know what I think? That
Merge records are a pretty big deal as well, right?
Do you know what I think is difficult to look at 20 years later, but what I think Trail of Dead had and what At the Drive-In had as well was like an intangible sense of cool. Like, they were both seen as fucking cool
bands.
That's
really true.
And I think that lended a whole lot of, like, credibility to them, and people just want to get involved with them, and, you know, that's, you know, just being like, oh, they're the cool new thing coming from the desert.
You're probably getting to the heart of it and saying that, and you go through periods where everything feels very forced and very calculated, and I think around about that time there was a sense of that. There was a sense of things becoming quite sterile, and then a few bands come along, because in amongst that bunch there was also bands like Liz Savvy Five, who never took quite as much as those bands, but they were there and coming from that same sort of, this is punk music but it's very kind of pop orientated. Yeah, and someone come along and is cool and it's dishevelled and it's not perfect, it's very imperfect in fact, and quite noisy, and the mixes do not correspond with your usual indie mixes. I think Trail of Dead, the mountain moved to them at the start, but then as it left them, they sort of tried to chase it a little bit, and I think I'll skim through their albums, obviously, as usual, but they seemed, as the more they chased it, the worse the output got. I was trying to think though of a basic analogy to try and describe Trail of Dead, and I would say that for me they are very similar to Sonic Youth. But if you had Sonic Youth and you got Sonic Youth to swap all their Velvet Underground records for MC5 records, and then maybe threw in an early Godspeed album and
Horrors Fugazi.
And Fugazi, and maybe even Definitely Maybe by Oasis. I know that sounds stupid, but
no, there's definitely some English,
a lot of English feel
to it. I had Sonic Youth, if I gave a fuck about Sonic Youth, a youthful Fugazi, and if Mogwai grew up in a warm country.
I mean, they've cited all of them as influences, obviously, as well as a whole bunch of classical influences that they said they were really into.
Well, it's interesting, Vivaldi is one that pops up, and you can definitely get, hear that sort of signature riff that you get a lot on Madonna and Source Tags. It's just kind of Baroque influence there.
Good word.
I actually, my advanced higher music composition was called Baroque and Roll, because I used a harpsichord.
That does sound like something you'd come up with.
Yeah, I know, pretty chuffed with it.
I think the thing is, though, and amongst all of those influences, the one aspect of Trail of Dead that has always really made them distinct is that they're a band that sound like they've drank too much coffee. They always sound like they are just hyperactive. The drums almost sound like the take was just a bit too fast. It's like you go back and say, guys, play that, but play it a few BPM slower. But no, they go with it. It's really full on. The drummers are playing at the limits of what they can actually do. Sometimes it seems like the tracks are going to just go off the rails. There's a real hyperactivity about them that then carried through into not just the lines of the drums that were written, but into them destroying the stage, into this sense of like pent up energy that was just exploding out. Them swapping roles, the fact that they were just too frustrated being in one role in the band, they had to constantly move around the band roles. The fact that the live sets were very fluid, especially in their earlier days when they had a lot of improvisational segues and a lot of post-rock in their music. I mean, even in their artwork, the artwork is exhausting to look at sometimes. It's so intricate. Like Conrad is an exceptional artist, and he does the art for most of the releases, and some of it is really intricate, very themed around almost like sort of Persian type look to it.
Sort of Indian Persian.
Yeah, and I was watching an interview with him about his art as well, and he'd been doing a lot of things that were like medieval ships, but then with like modern weaponry and drawings of like almost like elfin stuff in the background, and he wasn't really aware of the genre of steampunk, he says, and then it was someone said to him, look, your stuff's actually becoming quite steampunk, have you ever looked into that? Then he looked at that and realised that without even meaning it, he'd sort of gravitated towards this style of mixing modern elements way ancient, and that's like their music as well. They have shanties in their albums that then turn into full on punk, that then turn into like almost electronic post rock at points. They're a really, really odd band. It's a really odd blend of influences. Mark, I'm kind of curious at this point, what, if anything, you'd kind of heard by them?
Yeah, I remember seeing Source Tags and Codes and Kerrang! Magazine getting a shining review when it first came out, and I'd heard it back then. And
not
it was,
as shining, by the way, as Pitchfork.
10 out of 10.
10 out of 10, yeah. Perfect review. I think maybe one of the only bands to ever get that.
And Conrad laughed.
Certainly back, you know.
Yeah. Conrad says time. It's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. Eh?
Source Tags and Codes, I remember I seen the review of that and I thought, I'll give it a listen, and I gave it a half listen and I was like, this is too much for me at that time in my life. I never came back around to it. That's the only record I'd heard by them.
And how did it leave you?
At the time?
Mm-hmm.
I just like, it's just too much for me. I can't really get into it.
Is it the diversity of genres? Is it I wouldn't have thought the speed was too much.
There was no hook for me at that time, you know what I mean? I was like 17, 18, 17, 16, 17, something like that. And as a punk kid, I was listening to a lot of fucking pop punk and, you know, melodic hardcore and stuff like that. And it was all about big hooks and big riffs. And the band at that time, when I heard them, they didn't have them.
See, the thing, I think A Trail of Dead as a punk band, well, especially in their earlier career, like, bearing in mind, I'm more nuanced as they get on later, they become a wee bit trite, but their earlier stuff is punk music. It's very, very...
Yeah, but it's like 70s garage punk.
Yeah, it's like MC5, it's not like, Stooges type punk.
Yeah, it's not like 90s, you know, Californian hardcore
punk. Yeah, it's not SoCal, yeah. Whistle Stop Tour, their self-titled record, which was their first album, which is fairly hard to get, although I think it's been remastered now. It came out in 1998. The band had formed in 94, so they'd been a band for about 4 years. They'd started as a duo, actually, calling themselves You Will Know Us by the Trail of Dead, added two members and added the dot 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 and on the start. Couple of great songs on that album. It's good overall. It's not amazing. Richter Scale Madness, the opening track, it's really simple. It's very kind of naive sounding song, very Sonic Youth-y. You can hear that they're into them. There's a track in it called Prince with a Thousand Enemies, which actually sounds a lot like Mistakes and Regrets, one of the standout tracks from the album after it, Madonna.
I really like Novena Without Faith on that.
It's an interesting one as well.
I think that's, you hear, it's quite indebted to Slint. You can hear their sort of, yeah, the more post-rocky sort of stuff. And it's very Mogwai as well.
That's a really interesting reflection as well, because I do hear a lot of post-rock in Trail of Dead, but not post-rock in any way in the sense of, you know, explosions, but in the sense of Slint.
Yeah,
like
in
those
the sense,
kind of, bands,
sense,
yeah,
of Slint. Of, it's funny how, you know, you talk about them trying to get to the end of the song and they've had too much caffeine, but then they're very happy to also just stop and take their time.
They'll they will do a caffeine crash where they suddenly go into these long extrapolated periods of like ambient sort of workout, and they did it live quite a bit as well. When I saw them in Mogwai, they really went into town on those bits. Interesting tangent as well, by the way, that Prince with a Thousand Enemies comes from Watership Down.
Oh really?
Yeah. Prince with a Thousand Enemies.
I haven't seen that in fucking ages because it makes me cry.
Exactly. So the guy that wrote that, whose name I've completely forgotten, I only just found out about this. He has another cartoon called The Plague Dogs. Have you ever?
Oh, it's so dark.
Have you seen it?
I haven't seen the whole thing. I've seen like bits of it. I couldn't watch it.
Oh my god, Mark, have you seen? You heard about this? I'm new to this.
Richard Adams, but yeah.
Richard Adams. So he has this book called The Plague Dogs, which is quite a long book, but there's a cartoon version of it as well. And it's sort of in that Watership Down theme, but it's way darker. I mean, Watership Down is child abuse anyway.
Yeah, basically.
You know, but The Plague Dogs is it starts with a dog in a test facility being drowned and resuscitated multiple times. At one point, a guy's out hunting and his dog is like playing with him. The dog jumps and catches the trigger and shoots a guy in the face with his own rifle. At another point, they send a guy out to try and track the dogs down because they escape from a test facility, and they kill the guy. I think the guy trips and falls and dies, and they eat him. And the animation is them eating this guy's body. And I mean, there's all sorts of things. The whole idea is that they're infected with the plague and the government's trying to track them down, and their dogs are mentally ill. Man, it is dark.
That's what's going to happen after Brexit.
It is like a post-Brexit documentary, to be honest.
So dark. So Plague Dogs, folks, if you want to permanently damage your children without any real legal sort of fallout. Then there was Madonna. Then there was Source Tags and Codes. The fifth album was Worlds Apart, which came out 2005. There was a little bit of a gap. It was also on Interscope. It starts really well, that album. I'm a big fan of the first half of it. Mm-hmm. It's the usual thing with Trail of Dead. They tend to have intro tracks that are kind of slightly throwaway. The second track's called Will You Smile Again. It's this really great 6 minute plus tune. Big intro, drops down, goes into this big, gradual, very mature building arrangement that is just really rewarding to go through. The title track, track three, Worlds Apart, a bunch of kids laughing, and then Conrad going, "Hey, fuck you, man." This really buoyant, catchy, upbeat tune. Number five, Rest Will Follow, is a great Trail of Dead tune. Really sweet, positive feeling, dead tuneful. It's also got a bunch of weird seagull noises in it that really amuse me. And a single off that album, number six, is called Caterwaul, which is a really big, energetic single that I think really suits the name. It's actually a really good first half of an album, but it goes right off a cliff for me. The second half of that album, just everything feels underworked. It feels like if they'd waited a bit longer, although it'd been 3 years, they maybe ran out of time. They were like, we need to put out a record. Because as good as that first half is, the second half is deeply unremarkable, I think. It got an absolute kicking from NME, which is ironic given how much NME absolutely sucked up to this band. They said something about that it was trying to intellectualize its place in the canon of Western music, and in so doing, recognized its own irrelevance, which is deeply ironic coming from the NME, the most irrelevant magazine in the planet right now. This album was followed by So Divided, which was 2006.
NME gave that 8 out of 10.
Oh, man. And this is their weakest album.
It's not good.
It's really, really weak. It really goes off the rails. It's like they're looking for a new identity, but it falls really short. There's like a brass bit in the fourth track, Naked Sun, with a sleazy rock and roll thing. It just doesn't feel natural to them. Track six, the title track, sort of veers into Oasis territory, and that's something they do. Even though the delivery is different with Trail of Dead, they do occasionally hit on riffs and bits of songs that are totally interchangeable with Oasis. Mm-hmm. Like a really strange feature of the band.
There's that single on, I know it's skipping ahead a bit, but the one that you sent us on 9, Lie Without a Liar, just sounds like Feeder.
Oh, stick it up your bum, you. Track 8 on So Divided, 8 Days of Hell, is this weird Beatles-y kitschy thing. Sounds a bit like Get By With a Little Help From My Friends. I really think this album, they didn't know who they were going to become, what they were going to do to try and stay
relevant.
Yeah. But this, the Village Voice said that this sounded bloated where it thinks it's profound, and actually kind of, I think that's kind of an appropriate summation. It also features Amanda Palmer on the track Witch's Web, so there you go. They followed that with an album called Century of Self in 2009. Century of Self's okay. So it's got a bit more electronics in it. They'd expanded their live lineup way back in 2004. They'd been touring with two drummers. They'd added electronics. The two drummers was a nice live feature, and it suited given how frantic their drumming was, but there's also something slightly lost in it. It just seemed like you're kind of over-egging.
Kind of theatrical.
It didn't last, ultimately. This album sounds a bit more like Trail of Dead. The third track, Isis Unveiled, is a really gallopy song, and it's pretty strong early on. Track six is very much like a sea shanty, again reflecting that ship theme that they do a lot. It sounds almost like a kind of more amped up version of the band Two Gallants. Do you know Two Gallants?
Never heard of them.
Alright.
Well, I've heard of Galantis.
Well, I'm going to nominate Two Galantis at one point for this as well, so you're going to have to. One of the strongest parts of this track is that tracks 10 and track 13 are Insatiable Part 1 and Part 2. That's actually, it's 3-3. It's got a really emotive, catchy sort of central chord progression, and it's a really good conclusion to the album. That Century of Self album, they also abandoned multi-tracking largely on it. Well, not completely, obviously. I'm sure they did a number of overdubs, but they played most of the core parts of the songs live. A website, though, at the time, Under the Radar, had, I think, ironically accused them of selling out on that, which is, you know, they'd just been dropped. So, and Blender, had, which I think is now defunct, had said that it was plagiaristic. I think they're guiltier of that on So Divided, but I mean, Century of Self is not an amazing album by any means, but it does have good moments on it. In 2011, they did Tao of the Dead, which is, helpfully, they don't have track numbers, it's got track letters. And it turns out this album's split in half. So the first half of it is played in the key of D, and the second half's played in the key of F. The band had stripped down again from the big six piece to just a four piece. This really sounds like Trail of Dead again, and until we started researching this show, I'd kind of overlooked this album because I thought I'd been put off by the two or three before it to some extent. It's actually really pretty good. The second track, Pure Radio Cosplay, would fit pretty comfortably, I think, on Source Tags and Codes. Third track, or track C, Summer of All Dead Souls, has a really nice central guitar motif. It's quite snotty as well. Track 4, Cover the Days Like a Tidal Wave, track D, starts really subdued, but there's an arpeggiator that appears halfway through it, and it leads it into this big, energetic second half that works really, really well. Track 6, Wasteland, segues its way really nicely into track 7, Spiral Jetty, and Spiral Jetty has a brilliant chord structure and vocal progression. Just listening through the track, I kept flicking that one back. It's brief, it's only about a minute 40, but it's excellent. Track 8 goes out of that as well. It kind of all merges together really nicely because it's in the same key to a tune called Weight of the Sun, which kind of starts as a shanty but then bursts out into this really vintage Trail of Dead bombastic classic. It's a really, really underrated song. And the 11th track, The Fairlight Pendant, I think it's called, it's really krauty And that's not something they've done a lot of, but they're actually quite good at it. And I think that's quite informed by the stuff they did in their offshoot Midnight Masses, which we'll give a quick mention. But it ends really well, and it seems like they're more at ease with the electronics. The electronics feel less contrived in that album. Two left, Lost Songs, which you already mentioned, which came out, what year was that, 2012? Quite energetic. It's got more of that kind of early career hyperactivity. The drum beats are really frantic. There's a lot of tom work. Trailer Dead do that all the time, where other people might just do a hat, kick and a snare. They just put in like 4 or 8 hits in these toms, so everything sounds dead busy. Track 5, the title track, Lost Songs, is quite a fun example of them doing an almost post-punk thing for the 80s. Wee hints of the band Wire. Lost songs are going Track 9, Catatonic, is one of probably the most standout, because it's got a almost like a kind of math rock central lick that repeats all the way through. The album's maybe a wee bit light on melodies. It's maybe a wee bit style over content, but it is a return to something that sounds quite natural for them. And I do have a feeling that if I give it a chance, I'll give it a few more listens, there'll be stuff that jumps out. And then finally, to date at least, because I think they do have another album mooted fairly soon, but the album 9, or Roman numerals, you know, IX, is surprisingly strong. I really was taken aback at how good this was, because again, I left it towards the end of the research, but it's got a really good balance of the energy, but has stronger hooks than the album prior. The second track, Jaded Apostles, has a really good chorus. Third track, A Million Random Digits, is sort of the typical kind of frantic, propelling drum beat, but with a slightly more minor key. It doesn't do a lot, that song, but it does really, really well. Fourth track, Lie Without a Liar, is the one that I sent to you. Feeder My Arse.
I think it says like Feeder.
I think it's a real standout, and it has this really emo tinged kind of hookiness to it that reminds me of kind of later era AFI, with this kind of overwrought chorus thing, which sort of appeals to this teenager in you. It is a little bit hammy, but it's hammy in a nice way. Sometimes you want your music to just, you know, if you're going to be a bear, be a grizzly. It really goes for it. I'm not sure how well that song will age, right now I'm really enjoying it, and again I think that stuff's benefited from Midnight Masses. There's a much bigger sound on that album as well. There's really grand sense of scale. The sixth track is where Dragonfly Queen has a bit of a Cure vibe to it and just skips along really nicely. I was surprised at how many good moments there are through the rest of the albums, which I'd previously really written off. I didn't like them as a whole, so I wasn't willing to sort of pick and choose, because especially when an album segues, it's very hard to pick and choose and even get a sense of the landscape of that album. You don't know when that song just ended, you don't know when the next song began, the bit you liked, you don't know where it was in the album. But there are more points in their later albums than I gave them credit for initially, and that last one is surprisingly good. The only other thing, like I said, I would throw in is just the band Midnight Masses that they did as a side project. It's Autry Fulbright, who's now the bassist in Trailer Dead. He does vocals and a bit writing, and he's one of the main guys in Midnight Masses. And I've only got their first album, but it's really pretty decent in places. The second track is called Am I Nomad, and it's brilliant. It's a really shoegazy pop song, and there's a track on it called Everywhere Is Now Here, Nowhere Now Here, and that's a total krautrock one. And a track called All Goes Black, which kind of recalls some of the 3-3 stuff in Trailer Dead, and they're definitely worth giving a wee listen to. But none of that stuff, as good as some of the moments are, none of that stuff has ever been close to either of those two albums, whether it's Madonna or sources tag, source tags. So I'm going to have to keep correcting myself on that now for the rest of my life.
Sorry to ruin it for you.
And I don't think the band are under any illusions about that. I certainly don't think any of their fans are under any illusions about that. They had a heyday.
Yeah. And it's interesting that both albums came on either side of signing to a major. It was like the album that got them signed and then the album that they produced while still full of that sort of youthful energy.
Whilst not jaded.
Whilst not jaded by the major label system. Hi, sorry to interrupt your listening. I suppose Chris and I should both beg you for money this time.
Let's try and speak in sync without having rehearsed it.
So like a boy band on a children's TV program. This just shows
that
we should not
very similar thought processes.
A boy band.
Right. Mark,
yes,
you want to do a cash call?
I know. Well, we've just found out that the world is running out of insects, so we are kindly asking you to donate money towards us.
Just give us money.
Give us some money, and insects. Hopefully we can buy some gear for this podcast.
Buy some insects.
Buy some gear.
And then once we've done that, we can try and make a success of this podcast, get full-time jobs, get a full corporate sponsorship, and then once we're millionaires, we can purchase little spaceships to go and
die in space,
colonize a new planet that has insects.
Well, this is the cash goal. Here we are getting carried away. All right,
anyway, thanks very much.
We could use some cash,
So hit up unsungpod.net/donate.
yep, they give us some money for some stuff.
Thanks very much. It's much appreciated when you do, truly. Bye.
It kind of makes you wonder if some of it or a lot of it was written before they signed to a major label.
Mm-hmm. I mean, certainly, they are records that work very well together, and you can see a lot of source tags sort of coming from Madonna, and you know, the riffs sort of echo each other sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
They'd actually, the first thing they released in Interscope was an EP of one of the tunes, a four track, I think, and then source tags came a year later. Madonna wise, let me fight my corner first.
Fight your corner.
That opening track on Madonna, where they simply chop up little audio samples to say the name of the band, is really iconic.
And
we'll
know them
by the trail of dead.
It's a really ballsy, idiosyncratic thing to do. Okay, the band has a name that's conducive to that, because if you only got two words in the name of your band, it doesn't really work. But it's a very, very iconic opening to an album. Out of that tune, they go straight into Mistakes and Regrets, which is one of the best known of the band's canon. That song, to me, heralds the arrival of a pretty special band.
It kind of sums up what the band are. I find it like it's like it's meandering, kind of proggy thing, as well as being this sort of punky, noisy, slightly emo thing.
And it sounds like it's going to be a kind of trundler at the start of that song, and then it just speeds up suddenly and becomes this really explosive tune. The guitar refrain is really simple, but just kind of slightly anthemic. The vocal I love, it's pitched perfectly. The vocals aren't particularly melodic in this song, but they have just pitched them at just the right area for them to work, to have enough energy for his voice to really be strong and be catchy without being particularly tonal.
It's like what Fugazi did a lot.
Exactly.
Same kind of vibe.
Exactly.
Vocally.
Yeah, and but Fugazi were able to alternate between Ian and Guy, yeah, depending on what pitch they were aiming for. The rhythm guitar as well in that track just sits on the root and it lets that guitar lick do all the movement. It's just brilliant, really energetic. Out of that, they went to Totally Natural, which is the first sign as well that this is a punk band. Totally yeah. Natural is a punk song. It's really full on. It's barely contained. Like I said, it sounds like the drum take has been too fast.
Yeah, it speeds up and you're just like, oh, what the fuck is going on here?
And it sounds there's many points in that first minute. It's only a minute 20 before the song just goes right off the rails.
Then they show that they're really in control of like the dynamic range.
Exactly.
There.
And it evolves from that breakdown into this weird building motif about like street fights and all the tension gradually builds. The chains look broken. One more and then it kicks back in. It doesn't kick back in at the fast speed.
It doesn't.
It's half-timed. Mm-hmm. It's got this little anthemic quality, and then it bursts back in to that full speed thing, and then again breaks down into the carnage. I just love the chaos of that song. The fourth track, Blight Takes All, which I'm pretty sure is the one that was on the Cinnamon Grahams.
This is where the vocals sort of stray mostly towards emo.
I said like pop 90s.
Yeah, maybe.
Like it's like a pop song struggling to get out of like the noise. It just never quite gets there, and that's cool.
Exactly right, yeah. And that's also why I think the sequencing of this is so brilliant, because in the first three tracks, the opening track is just cool. Yeah. We're talking about notions of cool. The first thing is just a cool thing to do. It's like, fuck, that's really clever. The first three tracks, proper three tracks, including this one, show three different sides to a band. You've got this kind of sonic youthy, super cool, you know, anti-rock band. You've got this punk carnage. Then you get this song, Blight Takes All, which is very well structured. It has a really strong main vocal. It has this, you know, this refrain, what else can I do? And it's just a really, really great way to try and demonstrate all these different facets to this group. The fifth track again expands that even further, Clair de Lune, which is the 3-3 beats, very...
Yeah, it's kind of got a dramatic pull to it.
Yeah.
I think that really works in this sort of... Yep. Narrative of the record.
I agree again.
Do you know what song it reminds me of? And in no way, I don't think it sounds like it, but in terms of how it affects your listening to a record, is Mascara on Around the Fur by Deftones. Mm-hmm. In that it's not what you're kind of expecting. It's sort of, and it's like a tension builder. Mm. So it's like, oh, we're actually going to maybe tell a story with this record. It's not just 10 punk songs.
You need that at this point.
Yeah,
you really need
that break, that change. You need the change of tempo, you need the change of vibe as well. It gives you time to catch your breath. Well, the moon settled down once the move hit town. You know all the moves I seen. You never did understand how I watched all of them. But I also like in Clair de Lune is controlled as it is, and it's around about 2:30 where he's kind of saying that line, is it ought to know, and he gradually, his vocal, he slips the reins with it. The vocal just takes off and just becomes really messy and sort of like, it's like he's lost a bit of control. I know. which kind of suggests again that barely contained energy that's in the album. So even when it's not spilling over, it sounds like it's about to spill over.
The mellow bridge part, it gave me like a Nirvana vibe almost. You know, like when they go quieter and they go to bust into that next big bit.
No, Flood of Red, the sixth track, it's actually not my favourite track in the album. I think they went to try and show more of their kind of sonic youth thing. The vocal on it sounds, it's got a Lou Reed approach. It's that very loose sort of, again, almost, it's not very tonal. It's just, it's not spoken, but it's certainly not melodically sung either. I do think it's a decent bit of music. I think it's probably,
it doesn't stand out
in a very good album. It probably it sags just very slightly. It's followed by that song Children of the Hydra's Teeth, which is that creepy sort of almost Indian segue. But again, I do think the segues in this album, I don't think it sounds like they did it and then tried to jam it in. I think they actually were like, we need something here to make this really work. I think the production team have really helped. They'd done their first album with Chris, inverted commas, Frenchie Smith. And they then did a bunch of later albums with him. But for me, the kind of heyday period, Madonna, Source Tags and Codes, Worlds Apart, and even into So Divided and Century Herself, they did with Mike McCarthy. I suspect this album would never have been as good as it is if it hadn't have been under his tutelage. There should have been a lot of really, really savvy production decisions made during this.
Well, I think it's interesting that you talk about that, and bands like this quite often are sort of directed by a producer that gets the most out of them. And once again, we look at The Drive-In, who had Ross Robinson get the absolute fucking most out of them. And, you know, you have a band that are incredible live, have that sort of energy, but it takes somebody outside the band to be able to sort of harness that in the studio, because it's a completely different thing. So, yeah.
Another thing he's done really well, which is maybe as a lay listener, as opposed to a musician, you perhaps don't consider as much. He's considered the ebb and flow of the album. I don't think Trail of Dead necessarily need individual, like, this is a heavy tune, this is the light tune. I don't think they need that. They don't do that because the dynamic tends to be within the songs itself. You'll have these huge songs that will start heavy and then have 3 minutes of almost trippy post-rock in them, and like vice versa, you'll have these other songs that start very, very gentle and then just suddenly burst and double their speed and become these huge things. So the dynamic is actually, the songs work well on their own as opposed to just in the context of the album, because they have so much variety within. And one great example of that sequencing being done really well is Mark David Chapman, the eighth song. Mark David Chapman is my second favourite Trail of Dead song. Thanks. An absolutely brilliant song. Super simple, really well considered.
It's the most Fugazi song that I think they've done.
Yeah, but I think it's... But,
like late Fugazi. I think this is... This track you could see fitting on The Argument, which, funnily enough, came out before The Argument.
It's a more mature version of that. Yeah, it has elements of Sonic Youth in it, but good elements of like the better Sonic Youth. Sonic Youth when they're more focused and less pretentiously wanky, and there's a youth anthem quality to it, and I really think there's a youth anthem quality to this song that rivals anything that Sonic Youth put out, anything, and you know, Daydream Nation, any of that. So this is a brilliant song. By the way, Mark David Chapman,
John
Lennon's killer, has been denied parole 10 times.
Unbelievable.
Next up for parole.
Well, he's not going to kill.
He's 63 years old now.
He's not going to kill John Lennon again, so.
No, apparently he's a danger to the public, but he's up for parole in 2020.
Interesting.
Wow.
There you go. And talking about up for redemption. Hello.
Hey.
Track 9, Up for Redemption. It's just this little vocal ambient thing, because I think they end this album in a big way, and it makes sense to just, you have that, you digest it, you have this little 50-second segue, and then it's the song Aged Dolls, which is one of the most iconic moments of Trail of Dead's career. It's one of the epitomes of what they are and what people think of when they think of them as a band, at least people that were fans of them earlier on.
Because it's kind of everything.
It's everything. Yeah. Yeah. It has that big, big, big crescendo guitar crash where the guitars are matching with the drum splashes. Then it breaks right down, breaks, like falls away, way down to this really quiet, plodding little, like, delicate thing. And it's why this band is very, very different. Even to bands like Sonic Youth, it's why they just have a sense of drama, a sense of like spectacle that other bands really lack. The big to small. It's got that beautiful little piano descent in it as well. And then at 4:30, it goes into that massive prog outro. Which is like, it's about 3 minutes of something that could easily be Godspeed You Black Emperor. Like it's just this beautiful, beautiful thing that they did live on that first tour to great effect. I'd never heard of them when I saw them in Mogwai 99 at Liquidrums, and I was like, what is this band going to do? And then rather than just playing a bunch of punky, rocky bangers, they had this like 4-5 minute Mogwai-esque bit of music, and then they were back into, I mean, I'd barely remember the Mogwai show that night. They were so good. After that, you've got this piano led segue called The Day the Air Turned Blue, and then what I would say is a lot of people's favourite Trail of Dead song, A Perfect Teenhood. Again, absolutely iconic for them. The best, the most popular track at their live show recently, and the most popular track at most of their shows, in my experience anyway, in terms of getting the place moving. It just shifts up and down, speeds up, slows down.
It's got that sort of thunderous, like, buzzsaw bass tone, or yeah, guitar tone.
The tones in it are excellent. Yeah. The decisions that are made, even things like the vocals, like it's a punk as fuck song, even down to the fact that he gets into that fuck you, fuck you, fuck you vocal where he just
keeps repeating it.
Reminds
me of like Bleach era Nirvana. I don't know why, but like, because it doesn't necessarily sound like it, but it's just that attitude.
The attitude. There's an unfussiness. It's just they've let the chaos kind of take over. I think the producer's probably fighting to kind of rein it in, but the band are really leaning into it in this song. It really struggles to stay on the rails again and has another of those beautiful big prog outros. And then the album finishes. Actually, Sigh Your Children is not very long. It's only about 2 minutes because it's then a bit of space.
And then a secret track.
A secret track. But it's got that out the door ending, which... Again, seeing them live, everybody was singing along to it. It was a really great anthemic conclusion. I mean, they'd been a band for 5 years by this point, which, in my experience at least, is where a band is at its prime. In the early days, at least. I mean, maybe you've got bands like Radiohead that go on to then do something else. But you've been together 5 years, you know each other well, you know you've got a sense of identity, you're not aping other bands as much. I think this has moved away enough from the Sonic Youth thing, whilst obviously inviting comparisons. It has all these other elements that other bands weren't doing. A great sense of dynamics, a sense of confidence within it. I honestly think it's wonderful. And like I said, I started thinking I was going to say do Source Tags and Codes, and it was only really reappraising this. And the big hitters of like Age Dolls, Mark David Chapman, Mistakes and Regrets, and Perfect Teenhood, I was like, my God, any album with one or two of those on it, but all four of them on that one album is incredible. I will say my favourite Chilla Dead song is not on this album. So over to you, David.
Well, Mark, what do you think of that record?
I kind of lost it at Mark David Chapman. I felt as though I'd seen all the tricks and that was it.
Aged Dolls and Perfect Teenager after
Aged Dolls, they're good songs, don't get me wrong.
Oh my God.
But for me, I was getting fatigued by the end of it, even though the last couple of songs are brilliant. I do like Aged Dolls and A Perfect Teenager, which I have written down here, but when I get to that point, I was kind of like, oh man.
I mean, they put you through a lot.
Yeah.
It's quite an intense listen, and I think maybe that's why I wanted to switch to Source Tags and Codes, because I think what Madonna is like the perfect capturing on record of an amazing live band, mm-hmm. right?
That's fair.
And I think what Source Tags and Codes is that switch of a band being fucking brilliant in the studio for its own sake.
Better songwriters,
slightly better songwriters.
Yeah.
Like the production's sharper a little bit, you know. Like, because I fucking love Madonna.
I can tell, but can I just say as well? It was mentioned to give a bit of context that the budget for Source was a lot bigger,
yeah.
which allowed them to orchestrate it, and I think it benefited in a lot of places from that. Definitely.
Yeah, and I mean, you can see from the records after that that having the budget doesn't mean you're a good band, and having, you know, the chops doesn't mean you're going to produce something really good. But I think they were able to make the most of the means at their disposal with Source Tags and Codes. Madonna is like a really fucking brilliant, warm, sweaty album. It reminds me of like sawdusty rooms and, you know, like sweaty clubs. Whereas like Source Tags and Codes is a band expanding on that and being like, right, fuck it, we're in the studio and we're going to stretch ourselves even more.
Yeah.
So, you know, once again, we've got Invocation, you know, a really cool starter.
See, Invocation is an interesting one as well, mm-hmm. because I was trying to put my finger on what I thought had changed, and perhaps it's the budget and the sense of maybe pomp, and I'm not meaning that to like slag it off, but that little slightly pompous vibe to it. And that first track, I was like, what is it this is making me? And it's Smashing Pumpkins, Melancholy and Infinite Sadness.
Yeah.
And I felt like maybe the Fugazi edge had been replaced a little bit by an almost Smashing Pumpkins vibe. I would want to say, qualify that by saying Melancholy and Infinite Sadness for me is a fucking excellent album.
Yeah, there's a
album,
lot of people that would,
and this is the best Smashing Pumpkins album, but I do think that a little bit of the roughness was replaced by a little bit of pompousness, and...
But I think that can be enjoyed.
Of course, I mean, and I very much do, but I do think that perhaps explains some of why I veered back towards Madonna the more I was like, I'm hearing a bit more Billy Corgan in this. Yeah, go on, but I just want to bear that in mind because there's a couple other points where it comes up.
Well, it was there that I saw you, this, like, immediately you said that they're a band in the studio, but this is angrier, you know, it's sharper. This track it's crisper, but it's still fucking loose and full of energy. It's not lost that buzz. They're still saying, we are still one of the best live bands in the fucking world.
It's consistent with Madonna.
Yeah. Full of fucking beans.
But the dynamics are so much clearer with the production on this song.
Yeah, exactly. It's still got like the slacker vocals and the band just fucking going for it, but it sounds just that little bit more deliberate, like it's just capturing it a little bit better. Funnily enough, last night when I was at Tears for Fears, I was with my good friend Joe Rattray of many bands in Glasgow, and because we were sitting up in the balcony in the Hydro, the vast Enormodome in Glasgow, I took my glasses because I started needing glasses last year because I'm now old.
I feel you.
Joe hasn't been wearing his glasses for a long time, and he was like, you know, I can't really see much. And then I gave him my glasses, and he was like, holy shit, I can actually see the guys on stage. But we were talking about the sound as well, and the sound last night was fucking incredible. And I was like, yeah, it's like I've put these glasses on my ears. It's just made everything really clear. And that is kind of what Source Tags and Codes and the production on this record, it's like you've put glasses on Madonna.
Glasses on your ears.
Like suddenly everything is crisper and clearer. And
the album, not the singer.
Not the, yeah, exactly. I mean, Madonna can wear glasses if she wants. And I suppose some people like that sort of merge of colours and not being able to tell the sharpness between defining features. But I think what Source Tags does is it gives you that clarity of what the band are capable of.
Totally agree.
They're going for it and they sound deliberate, but they don't sound like they're being too clever for their own boots yet. Another Morning Stoner is one of my absolutely fucking favourite Drill of Dead songs of all time.
You know, it's weird. I almost feel like Another Morning Stoner is the start of this album properly. It feels like, if you imagine it like a movie, that the
credits.
Invocations.
This is
the
now.
This is the start. This is the first scene. If you know what I mean.
Well, I mean, what it does is it goes back to that sort of root note riff that they've put down in Madonna on like Totally Natural, Mistakes and Regrets. Like his voice is sort of aching, the guitars sound fucking amazing, the drums sound ridiculous. Like I think it's in this track you notice like just how clear the drums are, and that snare sound is fucking amazing.
See, I've written that this is like a basically exactly what you said. It's really weird that we said the exact, we've thought the exact same thing about the first three songs, but I've thought it was like a really good distillation of the noisy thing that we're doing in Madonna.
Yeah.
But this is much more focused. One of the things that I found with Madonna is its intensity sometimes. It feels overwhelming to the point where I'm kind of like I'm looking up in the sky. There's so many different things going on at once, so many different fireworks going off at the one time. I don't really know what to focus on because the production's a bit scattershot. Whereas this, everything's a lot more in its place.
The only thing that I would say, and that's a fair point, but my familiarity with Madonna has allowed me to distinguish those features more. When you know an album really well,
yeah,
you can
actually
hear things that are quite buried because you become attuned to these little buried noises.
I mean, yeah, absolutely. But I mean, that's the same with anything. Like the first time I heard Pure Holocaust by Immortal, I thought it sounded like TV static, but now I can distinctly tell all nine tracks from each other.
But by the same token though, that's also partly why some albums have a longevity that others don't. So some albums can be very impressive on first listen, and then you've pretty much seen and heard all they've got to offer, whereas other albums, something about that production can actually start to yield other little subtle details that give that album longevity. Mm-hmm. And some of the most imperfect recordings are amongst those. And so
yeah, absolutely,
it can be a strength.
Like, I think that's the whole thing with whatever you vote for on this, just what side of the argument you come down to, like whether you want something slightly more ragged or something slightly crisper. Baudelaire, this is like the track that maybe makes this first of all stand out from Madonna, because it isn't just a clearer version of Madonna.
Yeah.
Like they're really pushing things a little, you know, they're stretching what you expect from the melodies and stuff like that. If you're a Trail of Dead fan and then you heard that, you're like, oh, okay, right, yeah, they're doing things a little bit different here.
I think it's a great song, Baudelaire, but what the fuck is it? I can't categorise it because I can't, you know, usually with a song, you're like, I can imagine another band that would do this, but with Baudelaire, I can't quite figure out who would make a song like that.
I'm not sure. I even got like weird vibes of like, I don't know, like Hot Hot Heat or something like that. It's but quite, like just in the melody or maybe, I don't know.
It's almost poppy, but it's also very British sounding. Sounding. And then it's got the horns at the end, which are like, okay, that's a choice.
It's really unusual. I mean, I think it's a great song, but it's a very idiosyncratic. I don't really know anybody. I think Hot Hot Heat's actually not a terrible shout in terms of something vaguely close to it.
Yeah, I don't know why, that was just the band that totally popped in my head and I haven't fucking heard them in ages, but then Homage EP.
Homage is awesome.
Yeah,
Homage.
Fucking Homage, yeah, sorry.
Homage. I prefer to pronounce it like, this is like fucking an expensive male aftershave.
I mean, this is Fast and Furious, truly.
Homage.
Well, they're a punk rock
band. This is a fucking heavy band. This is like, you know,
but it's more controlled than Madonna, right?
Aye,
it's like a controlled implosion.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's more controlled until they get to the solo, and the solo is fucking class.
Yeah, but the production still makes it sound like they're not about to completely fall apart. Like there's some method to the.
Is that better or worse though?
I think it works for them.
That's because you're a singer.
Personally,
I like my punk. Nah, I mean, don't get me, I love this song. This song is great. And I do agree that the better production makes it clearer. There's stuff on Madonna that is similarly frenetic. And this one is sharper and more precise. I think this song could almost though have been too clear unless they'd made that decision with a guitar solo just to have screaming feedback as a solo. That was a brilliant decision. Like, really, really interesting.
Next up is How Near, How Far, and I think this is Trail of Dead's best song.
It's got the best hook they've got.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
But do you know what? I think that's maybe because it's the first song they ever had. I think I might have downloaded it off Napster. So it was like one of like two Trail of Dead songs that I actually had because
everything else took like 5 years to download.
Yeah, exactly. And I realized, do you know what? I realized how impeded I was in my musical education by whoever the stockist was in Inverness HMV. Because it was literally the only shop that sold CDs within 150 miles. And I would read Kerrang or I'd read Terrorizer or I'd read fucking Melody Maker and I'd want to, you know, go and buy a well-reviewed album, but if Inverness HMV didn't stock it, I couldn't have it. So that's probably why I didn't have a lot of music that other people got into.
Why didn't you join Britannia Music Club?
Yes, of course. They were famed for their Texan alt rock series.
That's where I got my first Foo Fighters album. It's true. Five CDs for a penny, and then you're paying them up for the rest of your life after. My God. That.
I'm sure they had lots of a model now.
I don't know, I think this is like sort of signature big Trail of Dead track.
Mm-hmm.
Just really fucking big, beautiful, massive.
Yeah, I mean, I do like it. I
feel like it's like the centerpiece of this record. No,
no, I would say. I'm kind of biased in this because Heart in the Hand of the Matter is the best Trail of Dead song ever written.
Okay, so on the other side of Life is Elsewhere, which is like, once again, they do like a nice little segue, give you some breathing space. You've got Heart in the Hand of the Matter, which is, it's maybe the most indie track.
It's
certainly on this record.
Mm-hmm. It is an absolute godsend for mixtapes. See, Heart in the Hand of the Matter, if you want to introduce somebody to this band, it is so emotive. It's really...
You can get lost in it. It's like pushing and pulling
it's
everywhere.
It's a beautiful song. It's amazing. It's actually, it's so well layered and so well arranged. I even love the fact that he starts out by talking and then goes up a register to just lift the song so early on. I mean, it's good, even including the word apocalypse. Was it Ride the Apocalypse?
Yeah.
I mean, it's such a brilliant song. I absolutely love this song. And this is probably, looking back in it, why I was influenced towards doing Source Tags and Codes first.
Because this track stood out.
Because this track is just, it's I love it so much. I think it's an absolutely brilliant tune.
I like the mix in this, like the bass and the keys are a lot higher than everything else has been on the record so far, and it really helps like give the song like a propulsive feeling, whilst also being quite
mellow. This song is propulsive, mellow, yeah. You know? It's like, I've made many mixtapes where this sat really comfortably alongside bands like Interpol and things like that, in terms of that slightly emotional, but not totally overstated, and indie, not too polished, especially earlier Interpol went well with this, that kind of stuff. I think it's a really great bit of songwriting.
Monsoon, did you mention Nick Cave earlier? No.
No.
Did Neil, you're saying Neil was like into sort of stuff
Neil's
like
really,
that?
Yeah, Tom Waits, yeah. Nick Cave, that song.
Yeah, and you can definitely hear like, you've got like massive Mark Lanegan vibes on the voice here.
That's so interesting, right? Because I was going to say, go listen to Monsoon and imagine it as a sort of second to third album Screaming Trees song.
Oh, absolutely.
It sounds very, very, very much like Screaming Trees for the first minute, minute and a half.
I mean, Trail of Dead were touring with Queens of Stone Age around this time. You know, Mark Lanegan era.
The thing is, Screaming Trees especially were one of the stodgier grunge bands.
Yeah.
And this song doesn't sound stodgy, but it does sound like Screaming Trees for a long
but
period.
But it does sound like sort of Nick Cave, but like heavier. And I think it's where they really expand, we can strip this back and be darker, but also be more intense at the same time.
The strings at the end are my favourite part on this whole record.
Yeah.
That's, like, fucking, that's just my vibe, like all the way through.
Yeah, totally. And then they follow that up with just a little fucking punk explosion of
Days Have Been Wild.
Days Have Been Wild, which is fucking great.
It's, you know, Days Have Been Wild does what some of their later attempts at being fast don't do, which is it gets that balance of energy and speed and volume, but melody. So it's got a great hook. You know, it's not a sweet hook, but it's got a great hook. And I think sometimes when bands are like, let's write a heavy one, they forget that there can be a song in there as well. And that song is a good balance of
the
two.
Only thing for me that I didn't like was the weird vocal bit at the end. But apart from that, I quite like the song.
Relative Ways is next. Which is, I think, a great track.
I think Relative Ways really was their attempt to sort of do something. It appears at a similar point as Mark David Chapman, and I think it's that sort of level of let's pace this, let's do something kind of like mid-tempo that has like a real role to it. It's a great song. I don't think it's as good as Mark David Chapman, you know, pound for pound, but I do think it is really good.
Good chorus as well. Pop poppy one. It was one of the popular songs.
This was the song that the first thing they released on Interscope was an EP, and it was a Relative Ways EP. It was the song that effectively cemented, or at least in some parts cemented, their major label deal.
After the Laughters, then another sort of minute 15.
Another Smashing Pumpkins moment. It is really Smashing Pumpkins in its vibe.
I can get that. And then title tracks, Source Tags and Codes. Funnily enough, this was the one that I was like, this is quite Oasis-y.
That's what I've written as well.
It's got those chords in there. It's the most sort of English indie.
Yeah.
It's also a bit Sonic Youth-y as well.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Sonic Youth are always big over here. Even in, like, at one point, proportionally, probably bigger over here than they were in the States. They were really, really cool, but something about their songwriting really translated well into British sensibilities. And mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. Like this one captures a fair bit of that as well.
And then you think, you know, like, it is a good track, but then thankfully, I think for the record, they finish on Blood Rites.
Is Blood Rites on all the copies? Because I've got it as a bonus track.
It is a bonus track, but on Spotify, it's on the end of the song.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is that what it is? So I wasn't sure if it was on the vinyl. I don't know.
I think it's on certain versions of it.
Yeah. If you don't have Blood Rites on your copy, you should hunt it down, because it's a really good track. Very, very, very punk rock song. That's a really nasty one. It's one of their nastiest heavy ones as well.
I think it was just the North American release. I actually didn't have Invocation or Life Is Elsewhere either. The wee meandering parts, which is weird. So, you know, their home release didn't have quite important segues, and then the really good finish. But then I think like the UK, European and Japanese versions had them all. Mm-hmm. So to me, I had Blood Rites. I think I'm pretty sure I had Blood Rites on the CD that I got. I think the stockist in Inverness HMV must have had, you know, the UK version.
Do you remember when they used to get the import CDs and they had the little Japanese sticker down the left?
Oh,
I mean, they would bang an extra fiver on the copy.
Yeah. Fucking right. You knew you were cool then. But yeah, so like for me, I mean, I fucking love Madonna, but Source Tags and Codes has maybe three of my favourite five Trail of Dead tracks on it. And I just think overall, it captures a band slightly more at home in the studio, but they still haven't lost any of their power. They still haven't lost that ear for like a sort of shabby melody, or it captures their like sort of loose fury better.
Yeah, I certainly don't think they've lost anything, and I definitely agree that the production is crisper. I think what it came down to when I was really, given that I was actually trying to fight the case of Source Tags and Codes in the first part, I was trying to be really honest with myself. I was like, Madonna is a better batch of songs. I was like, Madonna is songs that these songs have been germinating a long time. Okay, they'd had a first album, but I think you always have a lot of ideas kicking about at the one time. There was a depth and a variety, and as I said, there was so much dynamic within each, almost all of the songs in Madonna. Something about that, the strength of that package of songs, even though, yeah, the production is much more rough and ready, to me, I've warmed to that, because a lot of things have come out. The more I've listened to it, I've become more attuned to little details, and I just feel as a collection, the overall writing is better and more iconic. That's probably the riffs on Madonna, the riffs on Aged Dolls, things like that are totally iconic. Whereas, as I admitted, I do think Heart in the Hand of the Matter, for example, is their best song. Mm-hmm. So don't get me wrong, Source Tags and Codes is a great album, but I think they just had a Goldilocks moment on Madonna.
Yeah. Well, I think where I would maybe just slightly disagree is that I think Madonna is the sound of a... Like, if they split up after Madonna and they stopped making music, I think you'd have always gone, I wonder what that band could have been.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if they split up after Source Tags, you'd have gone, that band did what they could have done. I think they reached their peak with Source Tags.
It's interesting.
And they allowed themselves to, you know, challenge themselves.
Yeah,
and it really worked.
It's interesting that we mentioned Baudelaire at length, because I do think that whatever Baudelaire was, and as we say, it was like a little bit of a kind of anomaly. It's like, whoa, where's this coming from? It's good, but what is it?
But it just slightly broadens the parameters of the entire record.
Exactly. But it also, that feature ballooned in their later releases, and suddenly there were 3 and 4 kind of versions of Baudelaire that were not quite as good as Baudelaire on every album, and they had all these kind of non sequitur songs that some of them were real swings and misses, and it's strange. I don't know where that did come from, where what sensibility was at play there, but it didn't always benefit their later releases. But I mean, they do think they've rediscovered some of their mojo, it seems, on 9. So it'll be interesting to see whatever they title this new one as, and when it arrives, be interesting to see how that turns out.
Mark, as the independent adjudicator, what are your thoughts on both records?
I prefer Source Tags. That'll probably be the one I go back to immediately. Both
but
good
in
records.
20 years, you might prefer Madonna.
Possibly. Both good records. But like I said, it just felt like there was too much going on. There was like a lack of focus almost in Madonna, which is good. I like a lot of records that are like that, don't get me wrong. That and Denise Nest side by side is Source Tags for me all day long.
Well, I think what we'll do as well is Dave and I will collab on a wee playlist of these as well, drawn from these ones and then a few bits and bobs from the other records. Because there is good stuff in amongst their other releases. It's just nothing is even remotely close to either of these two.
Definitely.
I think whoever wins, it will be by a nose, but let's see what people say.
Yeah.
Great.
I'm interested to hear that. So yeah, go vote on our Facebook page.
Okay, so and what are we doing next week? Is there an excited guy over here? Is there an excited guy in a Tears of Fears hoodie over?
Yeah.
Go on, Dave, go on.
Next week, we are finally doing the black metal mixtape.
Bring your corpse paint, guys, because we're going to get fucking black and white up near.
Yeah, inspired by the release of the new Jonas Ackland movie,
Lords of Darkness.
Lords of Chaos.
Which is about
Lords of Metal.
The early 90s Norwegian black metal movement, I think you would call it.
Movement.
And it
fucking
has
shambles.
Macaulay Culkin's brother starring
Kieran.
As
McSmally Culkin.
Is he Varg or is he Euronymous? I think he's Euronymous.
Yeah.
So it's actually showing at the Fright Fest, I think it is, a part of like a horror fest. Because I am doing the official
fuck off
after party.
Oh, I thought you were going to say you were going to introduce the film.
I mean, I wish
you're about to get scalped by a juice.
I mean, one day I will introduce a black metal movie.
We'll also be joined by Varg himself,
starring
via Skype,
starring a Culkin.
Marlon, notice how Mark's got contacts in the White Power movement.
But anyway, yeah. So
it's too much white wine.
We're going back to the mixtape format next week, where each of us will be bringing a black metal record.
Oh my god,
it's
going to be such a long fucking week.
Oh, it's going to be chaos.
What I'm going to be doing is bringing 3 black metal records myself and just punching myself in the face.
He's assigning black metal records to me and Chris.
David's going to shoot himself in the head, and me and Mark are going to make jewellery from
out of
his
the bones.
Skull.
Yeah, make some soup out of my brain as well.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it should be fun.
Already for the last week, I've had to like requisition lessons from friends of mine that are into black metal to try and get up to speed and sound mm-hmm. like I know what I'm talking about. Not just like Wikipedia.
I've given you my playlist. Have you gone through my playlist?
It's going to be what I'm putting on the way home in the car.
Yeah, but I've had to go deeper than that. So.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Oh.
The thing is, with so many resources explaining the history of black metal, I feel like I don't have to spend all my time ripping that shit apart.
Will I bring my 2 black metal coffee table books next week?
Yes,
yeah,
please. What we should do.
Well, I mean, it'd be useful this week, to be honest. But you can bring them next week, why not?
I mean, they're just a good sort of visual additions.
You have them leaving them out for your family to find?
All the time.
How do you feel about painting your walls black, Chris?
I have the whitest fly, yeah, that'd be... We just take a photo and invert it.
Yeah.
Fine. Anyway, thanks for doing this, guys. I really appreciate it.
That's all right. It's been a long time.
I'm really excited, so it should be good.
See you next week.
Cheers.